Hello, everybody. It is 11 o'clock, so let's go ahead and get started. So, hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Geering Up Live. We stream every single, or we're going to have a video out every single Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I see a lot of familiar people who are back. Let's go check out the chat right now. I saw Claire before. I see Jackie and Aiden and Megumi. So welcome back, everybody, and thanks for coming back. If you are new, we do have a live chat function. Our co-host today is going to be Shu Dan, and she will help answer all of your questions and all of the comments if you just put it into the chat. If you put a question into the chat, I will address them all at the very end of this stream live for you guys, so make sure you put in those questions there. Just a reminder, we did have a survey that ended and we had a prize for Dasha. However, we were unable to contact you, Dasha. It seems like the email you sent is invalid. So just send us an email. It's in the description box below telling us your email so that we can send you your prize. And we would really hate for you not to get your prize, even though you won. So go ahead and email. But today we are going to be talking about the sea, as you may have guessed from this photo over here. For you guys who don't know, this is a megalodon, which is basically this shark that they knew that it used to exist. And it was huge. Look at it just compared to a human being. That little tiny scuba diver compared to that giant shark. So today we're going to be talking about the deep sea. And have you ever wondered what the deep sea actually is? Or wondered what it takes for humans to travel to the deepest parts of the ocean, because we have done that. And how are organisms able to even live in those ocean depths without a problem, but we can't? So today we're going to be answering all of these questions and more through our exploration of the ocean depths. Okay, so to start us off today, we're actually going to do a quick demo. We're starting off with that demo, and while we do this, I want you guys to think about why or how this even relates to the deep ocean. It may not be super clear at first, but type your thoughts into the chat as we test this out. But before we do any demo, of course, we got to do our safety check. So today's demo, super safe. We're really just working with eggs and books, so nothing too dangerous. You don't need to tie your hair up, wear a lab coat, goggles, anything like that. But be careful when you are stacking the books on top of each other. Place them one on top of the other, one at a time, and be careful not to have any fingers underneath the stack of books. You don't want to smash your finger, right? And don't try this yourself. And if you have any allergies to like the eggs that we use, obviously don't do it. But I think you guys are smart enough to know that. And again, ask for parental permission and get supervision if you do decide to do this at home. What materials are we going to need today? Super simple. We are going to need 4 eggshell halves. So just go ahead, crack that egg. And there you go. You got an eggshell half. You got 2 halves. And you're also going to need some heavy books or textbooks. And now it's a really great time to whip out your school books and use them for something important, for science, right? So let's go ahead and get started. What I'm going to do in today's demonstration is I'm going to see how many eggs 4 eggshell halves are able to withstand before they actually crack and they collapse under the pressure of textbooks. So remember, when I'm conducting this, think about the deep sea and think, how does it relate? Type your thoughts into the chat. So what I'm going to do is I'll put my camera down so that you guys can see. And I'm going to get 4 eggshell halves that I have cut so that they're fairly straight-ish. They're not too rugged at the ends. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to place 4 of them like this, space them apart. They should all be approximately the same height. So I tried my best there. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to stack books on top of this. And I want you guys to guess, type in the chat right now if you're watching live, how many of these books you think I can stack on top of the eggs before they break. Now, you're not going to be able to see the eggs, obviously, when I put the books on top of them, because the book will block your view. But you can distinctly hear the crack. I'm going to move my mic close to it. So go ahead and guess how many books we can put on. Here's book number 1. It's a light book. No cracking so far. Didn't hear anything. I'm gonna get another textbook. Put that on top carefully.
Still no cracking. So we're at $2 so far. Here's another textbook. I'm going to put that on top. Didn't hear anything. We should be good. 3. Now let's try number 4. Still nothing. Can we do number 5? This is a heavier textbook too, so let's listen closely. There was a little bit of a crack, but not completely. Now let's go ahead and put our 5th textbook on here. And we're done. That really just did it. So how many did we get? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 textbooks. 6 textbooks. And they're fairly thick. I'll show you in one moment. Look how big these textbooks are too. They're heavy, heavy textbooks. So it's not a joke. But these 4 eggshell halves were able to withstand 6 thick textbooks on top of them. So they do have a bit of strength. As I'm showing you, these are big textbooks. And I'll show you the aftermath. They're absolutely cracked, every single one of them. There was a bit of cracking that we heard at the 5th book, but the 6th book really just took it home. So, oops, sorry. All right, so that's our demonstration for today. And you should have been thinking throughout the demo, how does this relate to the sea? We're talking about eggs and textbooks. I doubt there's a lot of eggs and textbooks in the sea, right? So, while doing this activity, the textbooks were actually used as an analogy for water, and the eggshells were an analogy for anyone or anything that's traveling towards the ocean depths. So imagine that each textbook that was placed on top of the eggshells is equivalent to another 100 meters, like downwards in the ocean, further down. And at a certain point, the eggshells can no longer withstand the weight of the textbook. And in our case, this happened at the 6th textbook, and you can do this at home and see how many textbooks your eggs will withstand. And this is equivalent to the idea that as we descended down further into the ocean, we begin to feel this immense amount of force from the water pressure being exhibited on us. And if every book represents about 100 meters of water, then we put 600 meters water of pressure on our eggs before they broke. So above the water, we're experiencing the pressure of just the air that's above us, the air above in our atmosphere. And there is a bit of pressure, like air pressure, just due to our atmosphere. There are a bunch of air molecules on top of us. But when we're underwater, we're not only facing the pressure of the atmosphere and the air particles above us, but also the water that's above us too, all of that water. And as we know, water is much, much heavier than air, and this leads us to having a more feeling of intense pressure on us when we're underwater compared to when you're above water. And if you've ever gone scuba diving, I know you can definitely feel this. You don't feel like you can move with ease, right? You got some pressure that's kind of pushing you down, making you feel a little heavy. So basically, because water is heavier than air, it's more dense, anything filled with air that's brought underwater is going to get crushed by the pressure of the water acting on it. I got this really cool video for you guys that I'm going to play. It's this scuba diver, and he is going to take his water bottle filled with air, or a soda bottle, and he's going to dive all the way down. And we're going to see that as he's going down, the air pressure, or the water pressure, is pressing on top of that water, and it's contracting it, and it's squeezing that bottle. Look at the bottle. You can really see it. Before, it was filled with air. It was nice and, like, big, but now it's getting crushed, right? And this is at 10 meters depth, so it's not even that deep if you compare it to how deep the ocean is, right? So the air is still in the bottle, and it floats up eventually. So we're going to see him, and he's going to go back up into the air, and he's going to show what happened to the bottle. So here we go. If you look at it, you can see that the bottle that previously wasn't crushed is now crushed. And that's because of the force that was exerted by the water onto that bottle, and it squeezed it. So the fact that you're able to travel to the deepest part of the oceans, which is 11,000 meters below Earth's surface, that force of water is going to be so strong that it would feel almost as equivalent to the weight of 100 elephants standing on top of you. So that's 11,000 meters below Earth's surface in the water.
And because of these crazy amounts of pressure that's felt when we travel deeper into the oceans, humans have to create really specific tools and submarines that can withstand such pressures. For example, the Deep Sea Challenger, it's just a submarine that I got over here. And you can see in the photo that it is submersible, and it was built and designed to be able to explore the deepest part of the ocean, which is the Marianas Trench, if you've heard of that before. Okay, now let's talk a little bit more about submarines. So because submarines and submersibles are designed to withstand the pressure of water, they usually appear quite unique from other transportation devices. Most submarines, whether for research or for military purposes, are conical in shape. And submarines are conical in shape because arcs, as you can see in this photo right over here, are the strongest shape in engineering. An arc is so strong because it distributes the force equally across the entire arc rather than having the force concentrated on any of the specific points if it was a different shape. So for example, rectangles and triangles, on the other hand, have distinct corners and edges that lead to unbalanced distribution of force. So because of this, if a submersible was designed more rectangular or triangular shape, it would buckle down under the pressure of water a lot easier. So although humans have designed submersibles and tools that would allow them to explore ocean depths, many organisms that live in these conditions every single day have to deal with that. So let's explore some adaptations that these organisms have that allow them to withstand the pressure of ocean depths, because nobody engineered them, right? Nature engineered them. They're evolutionarily just evolved to have these features that help them survive in these conditions where there is so much pressure. So a lot of marine organisms actually have something called a swim bladder. The definition is just right down on the screen here. And a swim bladder allows them to stay in place underwater and allowing them to conserve energy from having to constantly swim. So this is how we might kind of wear pool like floaties, like these children over here, when we go to the pool, allowing us to stay afloat without having to actually swim. And anything that's filled with air is going to easily get crushed by the pressure of the water, as we saw with that soda bottle that we took underwater that was filled with air that got crushed. So the same thing will happen to these. And in this case, because the swim bladder is filled with air and our pool floaties as well, we'll get crushed under extreme water pressure, just like what happened in the video I showed earlier. And as a result, many organisms that live in the deepest part of the ocean don't actually have a swim bladder. And this ensures that nothing's gonna get crushed under such extreme pressures. So these deep sea fish that don't have a swim bladder may choose to skim this ocean floor, or some sharks or even rays may use their fins to create a lift, kind of like an airplane would. We had an episode on airplanes before, so if you wanna understand that, here's a little bit of a connection. But yeah, a lot of marine organisms do have these swim bladders, but those are the ones that aren't too deep. The ones that are a little bit higher up in the ocean that'll stay close to the surface are likely gonna have these swim bladders, these fish, but anything that's in the deep sea likely won't, again, because of this crushing. So another adaptation though that some organisms may have is these organic molecules called piezolites. And these piezolites are able to protect the membranes and the proteins in the fish from being crushed by the water's pressure. However, scientists are still unsure of how this process actually happens. It's just something to keep in mind. Marine scientists also found that piezolites are present in shallow water and deep sea fish, although much more abundantly in deep sea fish. And this makes sense, as deep sea fish will require much more piezolites to withstand the greater water pressures. And we're still unsure about many things with the deep sea fish, because one of the main challenges of studying them is that we're unable to leave the submarine at the depths of the ocean, or else we're going to get crushed. The submarine has been specially made so that we don't die, but the outside conditions will definitely kill us because of that immense pressure and nothing to protect us. Even if you are wearing like scuba diving gear, nothing is really going to help you there. So what we are able to do, though, is bring these organisms back with us to the surface of the water because of the significant change in pressure, though, it will cause them to die instantly. So we can't really do that, although technically we could. It would kill them and then we can't study them. So that's a challenge that some marine scientists will face. Now let's talk about one of my favorite things. Blobfish. I find them hilarious. They're so funny looking. And a good example of this happening is the blobfish. So the blobfish is commonly known as the ugliest fish in existence. That's super sad though. But this was only brought up so quickly to the surface of the water where it doesn't belong. And the blobfish normally actually swims between 600 meters to 1200 meters underwater. So that's super deep. And at those depths, the blobfish is gonna look like any other fish.
As you can see from the picture over here on the top, the blobfish kind of appears to have a regular shape. And that's because once it comes up, it's usually just like an accidental bycatch by some fisherman's net, but its body struggles to actually respond to the rapid changes in pressure. And once it's brought up to the surface of the water really quickly, the blobfish body kind of turns to a jelly-like substance that gives them that infamous blobfish look. So this is as if we humans were forced into the deepest part of the ocean without any protective gear. And if this were to happen, we would also be changing a lot, and we would most likely be unable to survive as we descend to those depths. So that's exactly what we're doing to these blobfish. So they're not actually that ugly. It's just because of these pressure changes that we're making them succumb to. But now that we've talked about the intense effects of the water pressure in the depths of the ocean, let's switch over to a quick look of the ocean's four main zones. So we like to classify the ocean, and we like to classify things in science and split it up to things that make much more sense. So we have split it up into four zones, the first one being the sunlight zone. You probably figure this is the zone that is closest to the surface of the water, and it's going to have sun, hence it's called the sunlight zone. And then after that, we have the twilight zone, the midnight zone, the abysmal zone, and the hadal zone. So these are going to be just successively more and more dark as sunlight can't penetrate that deep into the ocean. So we found this super cool website here at Geering Up. I will put it on the screen. It should be linked below in the description box. And Shudan will go ahead and put this website into the live chat bar if you want to explore the website along with us. But I will go ahead and share my screen. And we are going to see this cool website. You're going to see why it's so intriguing. So here's the website. Now let's scroll all the way to the top. So this is a website called the Deep Sea. And as we scroll further and further down, it shows us the depths right over here where the meters are written. And then we can also see the names of the zones, the animals that are in the certain zone. And then we can just scroll all the way down. Look how far it goes down. And that's what we're going to be doing today, just to explore the different zones of the ocean. Let me just fix my screen over there. Hopefully you guys can see it. So the first zone, as we talked about, is the sunlight zone. So we're going to find a lot of animals that we already recognize, like the salmon. That's something that I love. Salmon, it tastes delicious. We see there's a manatee. We see that we have coral. Those are the corals that are getting bleached in near Australia's coast, so you might recognize that. You can see a polar bear. Isn't it crazy how a polar bear, here's the surface of the water, can actually go 36 meters deep just by itself, and it's just swimming even though it's not a fish or anything. So I found that very interesting. And it's called the sunlight zone for this reason, as the sunlights are actually able to penetrate through this zone, and there's plenty of food on the surface of the ocean because many organisms that end up as food for other fish are able to harness energy and survive through photosynthesis of the sun, because obviously in the sunlight zone, we have the sun. And this zone lasts to about the 200 meter mark. And once we reach the 200 meter mark, we reach the twilight zone. And the twilight zone is going to be from 200 meters to 1,000 meters. There is significantly less light as the sunlight rays are not able to successfully penetrate into these depths. And due to the lack of light, the twilight zone is where we begin to see some of our few bioluminescent creatures. So I'll point it out once we see one, but basically bioluminescence, here we see the firefly squid, that's an example of bioluminescence, is basically the organisms are going to generate their own light that's actually not from sunlight. So think of them as their own personal lamps. So we see there's still quite a bit of animals that live in this twilight zone, even though there's no sunlight. Look how scary it appears. Look, the Empire Penguin dive is actually 551 meters deep approximately, which is crazy because it's just a penguin and it can't really breathe underwater with gills, right? So here we got the sunfish. We even got coral, which is crazy because it's a plant. We got the Japanese spider crab, which is the largest known crab with a maximum leg length of 3.8 meters, which is absolutely insane. This is a super fun website to explore. Like, look at all these interesting animals. So here, this is one of my favorites. The giant Pacific octopus can actually go 776 meters deep. So as I said before, this twilight zone is going to go to about 1,000 meters. You can go ahead and on your own time just explore all of these animals in the twilight zone. But at around 1,000 meters, we are going to reach the midnight zone. And the midnight zone goes from about 1,000 meters to the 4,000 meter mark. Absolutely no sunshine is able to penetrate these depths. So as a result, the majority of organisms that live here rely on bioluminescence. We saw a bit of that in the Twilight Zone before, but now there's definitely more of that. So it says that here, the anglerfish, here's another bioluminescent, it literally has a lamp kind of looking thing on top of it, and it uses it to attract the prey in the darkness. So it's like, as if my hand was a lamp. It's very interesting to think of if you think about it. So a lot of deep sea creatures have actually adapted to low amounts of oxygen too at these depths. As you can imagine, there isn't too much oxygen here. And they rely mostly on like dead rotting things for food. So like dead algae or plants and these animals from the upper zone that drift to the bottom of the ocean when they die. And the organisms in the midnight zone are accustomed to feeding quite infrequently, as they strictly rely on kind of waiting for food to float down to them, similar how pet fish might wait for food to float down to the bottom of the tank to be eaten, right? So we can go ahead and remember that this zone goes to 4,000 meters. So I'm going to skip really quickly just to 4,000 meters. If you guys want to, on your own time, explore this, it's totally fine, but I don't think we have enough time in today's stream. This is a really interesting website. So it's super fun just to sit down on your own time and look at all the different animals and search them up. So we finally reached the abysmal zone. So the abysmal zone goes from 4,000 meters deep to 6,000 meters deep. Isn't it crazy how deep the ocean is? And in this zone, the water is near freezing and there's very few organisms that are able to survive in these pressures. So we do have a species of sea cucumber actually. And these are able to live at 4,500 meters deep. And there's faceless fish at around 5,100 meters. So I'm just going to scroll there so that we can see it. But yeah, these are organisms that, here we go, the faceless fish. As you can see, it doesn't have a face. It doesn't have eyes because there is no light. If there's no light, why do you need eyes? Because you won't be able to see anything. So it's called the faceless fish, which is really funny to me. Now, and this is the abysmal zone. Remember, it goes to 6,000 meters deep. So I am just going to go ahead and skip to 6,000 meters so that we can see the very last zone that we are going to explore today. And that is the Hadal zone. The Hadal zone, here we go. More people have been to the moon than the Hadal zone. So that's really cool to think of. And it extends from 6,000 meters to the deepest part of the ocean at 11,000 meters. And as a result of the high pressure and the lack of oxygen, there's really few organisms that reside at these depths. As you can see, I'm scrolling and scrolling, and there's really not that many actual organisms that are living here. And it's understandable why, because it is so deep and there's so much pressure. So if you remember, at the very surface, there was a lot of organisms. But now, look, there's one out of how many thousand meters, right? So here's one. It's called the grenader. It is a fish that does live here. And it's likely that we haven't actually discovered a lot of the organisms that reside at these bottoms, and that's why so little information is known, because there's been more people on the moon than here. So as this thing says right over here, so little is known about life in these deep environments, almost every expedition uncovers everything new. So we just haven't simply explored enough, so maybe there are way more there. And once we reach about 10,000 meters deep, I'm going to scroll all the way down. This is the furthest that any man-made submarine has gone. And it's even incredible that we were able to go that deep. So this is where the Deep Sea Challenger traveled to. And this is the lowest point on Earth. And for reference, here is an outline. We'll get there. But there's going to be an outline of Mount Everest that you're going to see. And it'll show you how deep the ocean is. We'll get there. Eventually. It's a lot of scrolling. It really tells you how deep the ocean is. So here is the Challenger, which is that submarine that we did send. And it did go 11,000 meters deep, which is the lowest point of the Earth. So there you go. It is really cool. If you imagine that Mount Everest was in the ocean, if you were to submerge Mount Everest into the ocean and put it at the very, very bottom of the ocean where the Challenger was, it wouldn't even rise to the surface of the water. And we know that Mount Everest is like the highest mountain on Earth. So it really tells you how deep our oceans are. So it is something to explore on your own time too. That website, if I were you, I'd just go through it for a couple minutes, just explore what's in our oceans. But we finally reached the everyday engineering portion of our stream. So salt bodies make up over 70% of the Earth. You probably know that. There is only about 30% land compared to water. And it holds about anywhere between like 500,000 to 10 million marine species. And because of this, oceans play a really important role in how our marine biodiversity, and as a result, should be protected to retain ocean health. And like we mentioned above, many deep sea creatures rely on decaying matter, dying matter for food. However, as seas get more polluted, we start to see concerns where human garbage, especially plastic, kind of floats to the bottom of the ocean. And this causes a concern because, one, it's difficult to remove trash from the ocean depths, and two, this can cause huge problems for marine life if they accidentally ingest these plastics. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of the Save the Turtles thing. But basically, there were some turtles who got plastic straws stuck in their nose, and when they took them out, they were bleeding and they were suffering. So it is really, really upsetting to think about. But for example, on the page over here, we have a photo of this place called the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. And it's basically a bunch of human garbage that is collected over time just due to the currents. And many engineers and scientists are trying to come up with a new, efficient, quick way to clean up this large patch of garbage in the ocean. But it's not just a matter of simply picking it up. It's huge, right? And further, as we talked about, submersibles are essential to the human ability to travel to the depths of the ocean, which is why, again, engineering may be important due to studies of the ocean, because engineers want to design and create submarines that are able to withstand these pressures of the ocean depths. So there are two places here that we talked about that engineering can be applied. But what have we talked about today? Let's go ahead and summarize the things that we've learned today. Got a little blurb here for you guys to read. But basically, many sea organisms got a lot of cool adaptations to withstand immense water pressures deep in the ocean. We talked about the swim bladder for the people who are, or for not the people, for the organisms that are near the surface. But then we got a little bit different adaptations like piezolites for those organisms that are in the deeper part of the ocean. Next, we talked about submarines, which are conical in shape because arcs are able to withstand more weight than triangles and rectangles. So engineers have figured that out, and they have made our submarines with these shapes that will maximize the efficiency, basically. And third, we learned that the ocean is distinguished into 5 separate zones. Number one, the sunlight zone, where all the sunlight's basically going to penetrate. We got a lot of life. This is the layer that we got the most life. Then we got the twilight zone, it's getting a little bit darker. The midnight zone, there's absolutely no light. The abysmal zone, and finally the hadal zone, where there really isn't many organisms living there. However, there still is some, which is still really interesting to think about. Okay, and that has taken us to basically the end of our stream. If you had any questions, my co-host will send them, and I will go ahead and answer them for you now, or feel free just in the chat right now to put in your questions and I will answer them live. I really did enjoy this episode. We do have the link for that website that I used today in the description box below, so go ahead and just explore it. And it's really fun just to see. It's a really nicely designed website. It's fun when you can scroll down, and you can also see similar websites where it's like the universe and it goes into an atom and then it zooms out into like a planet and then the solar system and then our galaxy and then the universe, and just sites like that are super fun. But I don't see any questions in the chat, and my co-host tells me that you guys didn't have any questions about the stream. So with that, I will go ahead and end this stream. I had a great time with you guys today. I will see you next Friday. Bye, everybody.